Hello everyone, today I'd like to talk about normal distribution. I'm pretty sure that a lot of you already heard about this distribution before, which is also known as bell-shaped curve or Gaussian distribution. So many naturally occurring measurements of random variables such as height, weight, body temperature, blood pressure, glucose concentration, or even the errors of all these measurements are known to follow normal distribution. And this is considered one of the most important distributions in statistics because it is the base distribution from which other statistical distributions are derived. Before we talk about normal distribution in more detail, let's step back to the visualization of data and talk a little bit more about the shape of a distribution. So here is the histogram of hypothetical exam scores. Let's imagine that we have millions of data to plot a histogram. Even though there is no right or wrong answers in terms of what the optimal number of bins or width of a bin should be, but in general, if you have a large data set, then it's better to divide the entire range into smaller bins. So for example, here we have a histogram of the exam scores with 11 bins. Now let's increase the number of bins to 100 and see what it looks like. So we do this because we can and the data set is large. Now, if we increase the number of bins, naturally the width of a bin decreases. As the width of a bin decreases, the histogram looks smoother, as you can see. And if we keep dividing the range finer and finer, then it'll look smoother and smoother to the point where the outline of the histogram forms a smooth, continuous curve when the bin size approaches to zero. And then the curve is called a probability density curve. And when the curve has the following features, we call the curve a normal distribution curve. So this is a typical shape of normal distribution. And by the way, you should not use the word normal in normal distribution like in everyday sense. So when a distribution is not normal, then it is not an abnormal distribution. I sometimes, you know, see or hear people say the abnormal distribution, which you know, to mean the opposite of the normal distribution. Well, it is not, you know, exactly the opposite anyway, right? So you should not use the word abnormal. Okay, never ever say that in the context of statistics to refer a data set or distribution that is not normally distributed. Okay, I said this. Now, if a distribution is not normal, then it is just a non-normal distribution, or it is some other distribution with a different name. All right, so when describing a normal distribution, data scores, you know, values go to the x-axis, and the probability, occurrence, frequency, density, sometimes they say this is a density, go to the y-axis. So as you can see from this curve, normal distribution is denser in the center and gradually thinning out to both tail ends from the center, hence the name bell curve. And please note that those two tails never touch the x-axis, and they stretch out to infinity in both directions. And from the mathematical point of view, the normal distribution curve is describing how likely you will see a certain value in a data set. So for example, so if you have a data located on the x-axis here, then the likelihood that you will see this data under this normal distribution is found on the normal distribution curve, right? So the height of this data set to the normal curve determines the likelihood or the probability that you will see the data, right? So if you move to, say, like here, the center, then the likelihood that you will see this data is actually this much. Okay. And then this is basically the most likely observations you can see under this normal distribution. So because the normal distribution is symmetric around the center, and that is another feature of normal distribution. So whatever score in the middle is the most likely observations you can have in a data set, assuming your data follow a normal distribution, which will be the mean. So what that means is that the more typical or mediocre values, such as average, are concentrated in the middle under a normal distribution. Right? So these values are more likely to be observed in a data set. On the other hand, if you just go out to the tail, then that's where you can find more kind of a extreme data, right? So they are kind of a atypical data. And the normal distribution, so that is actually represented by the low likelihood, low probability of these data, right? So these are extreme. So if you think about like exam scores, right? So say the usual exam score is 50, right? So that is the kind of center. Then if you just go out to, far away from the mean, say you have like a 90, 100, and you have like a 10, 20, you do not find these scores quite often compared to the scores close to the mean, right? So that's actually what it means that that the middle scores are more likely to happen, whereas the extreme scores, so the scores in the tails are more extreme, and it is not likely that you see those data frequently. So another feature of normal distribution, as I said briefly just before, all the central tendency measures, the three central tendency measure we've learned, mean, median, mode, have the same location, which is exactly this, in the center of the normal distribution. And the normal distribution is perfectly symmetric around these three central tendency measure under a normal distribution. And another feature of normal distribution is that you can specify or characterize any normal distribution if you know their location parameter, and well, that is scale parameter, the spread parameter, which is sigma. So here, this is actually lowercase of sigma, right? To remember the big sigma here, right? And that is a capital. And then this is a lowercase of the sigma, right? And we use this lowercase sigma to represent population standard deviation, right? So here, this arrow represents spread, the average spread in the normal distribution, which is typically represented by the sigma. And then the mu, this is another Greek letter, mu, right, representing the location parameter of normal distribution. So that is just, where the center is, right? So that is the mu. So that line is mu, and that is sigma, right? So as long as you know these two quantities, then you can specify the whole normal distribution curve mathematically. And another important feature of normal distribution is what's called the 68 95 99.7 rule that relates the area or proportion under a normal distribution to the standard deviation. So this rule applies to any normal distribution, so you might as well just remember this. So according to this rule, the area under the curve bound by plus minus one standard deviation. So here the mu again represents the mean of the distribution, right? The center of the distribution. And if you go out to one standard deviation, so sigma here is a standard deviation, right? So mu minus one is the score where this is the below, so one standard deviation below the mean, and the other score that is located one standard deviation above the mean. So when the normal distribution is bound by these two scores, right, then the area under the curve is 68%, right? And you can find 95% of the area under the curve within plus minus two standard deviation. So that is pretty much like a most data you will find. I mean, the most of the proportions under the distributions. So say. So within plus minus two, so now you move another standard deviation far away from the center. And the area under the curve bound by these two scores. Now I just shade this. Okay, so that is 95%. Okay. And if you go out further to three standard deviation, okay, so that's three standard deviation below the mean and three standard deviation above the mean, then this area, green area, will be 99.7%. So this is just a rule. So you want to just remember it. Okay. So then, what does this area under the curve mean? That is just a summed probability under the curve. So before I told you that the normal distribution describes the probability that you will see a certain value, right? So for example, the exact probability that you will find this data under this curve is here, right? So that is just a single probability for this data set. But when you say the area under the curve, so that you want to calculate the area under the curve from this data to the negative infinity, right? So that means is that this is a summed probability that you will find this data or more extreme because the data to the left here, right? So that includes all the more extreme data from this data set, right? So that's what that means. So the area under the curve is a summed probability from a certain data point, right? And in this case, because this is in more extreme side than this data set, so you say the area under the curve in this red represents the summed probability that you will find this data set as big as this one or more extreme. So that's what it means. And by the same token, this means the same thing. So here, if your data is located here, then the exact probability is just find this data under this normal distribution you can just find here, right? So that is a single probability. But the area under the curve to this direction, right, represents all sum of all the probabilities, right? All the other extreme values than this one. So that is the area under the curve here. I sum the probability that you will find this data or more extreme. But that's what it means. So if, and what's the area under the curve in the middle? Again, that's the sum of the probability that you will find between these two data sets. So you add all the probabilities. Between these two scores. So that's the meaning of area under the curve. And this will become important later on when I try to explain the concept of p-values or alpha, the level of significance. Given a data set, any raw observation or score can be transformed to what's known as z-score by subtracting the raw score from the mean of the data set and divide that difference by the standard deviation of the data set. So this process of converting a raw score into a standard score or z-score is called standardizing, or sometimes it is called normalizing. Sometimes it can be confusing to use normalizing because it can mean something different too. Anyway, this way, any score can be expressed in terms of how far the score is away from the mean in the unit of standard deviation. So the raw scores above the mean will have a positive standard scores, whereas those below the mean will have negative z scores. So the mean itself then will have a z-score of zero. So these z-scores are typically used for comparison purposes. For example, you may want to know, you know, where your body weight stands in the population. So if you know the population mean and the standard deviation, then you can convert your weight into z-score to see how different you are from the typical population weight, which is the population average weight. And more generally, so if a variable X follows a normal distribution with the mu and a standard deviation of sigma, so here X represents any random variable, and this squiggly sign is red follows. So if a random variable X follows, this big N represents the normal distribution, right? And the normal distribution has mean of mu and the standard deviation of sigma, right? So this whole thing on the left is read, if a random variable X follows a normal distribution with the mean of mu and the standard deviation, then it'll follow another normal distribution with the mean of zero and the unit standard deviation when every score in that random variable X is standardized by this Z transformation or the standardizing process. So we can convert any normal distribution into a single standard normal distribution. So that's what that means. So here is an illustration of how a normal distribution becomes a standard normal distribution after standardization. So the distribution in light gray on the left is the original distribution following a normal distribution, right, with the mean of -2 and the variance of 0.5. So this is a variance instead of a standard deviation, because the reason that will become clear later on. But so that x, so that is the mu of the distribution, and this is sigma squared, okay, not sigma. I told you already before that sometimes the normal distribution is specified by either standard deviation or the variance, okay? So the mean of the light gray distribution is here, right? And the standard deviation is about, the spread is about here, right? That is actually square root of 0.5, right? Standard deviation. Now, if we follow the set transformation or the standardization using the equation previously. So the X is the all the scores of the original distribution in light gray, right? So you plug in all the numbers from the original normal distribution and subtract these scores from the mean of that distribution, right? Which is negative 2. And you divide this difference by sigma, right? So because in this equation, because of the square root, that means this 0.5 here is actually expressed in terms of variance instead of a standard deviation, right? So that's why I told you that this 0.5 is variance instead of standard deviation. Now, if the X goes through this transformation, then the resulting distribution is in this black distribution on the right, which is the standard normal distribution. So now the all the scores are the z-scores converted to z-scores following the normal distribution of with a mean of 0 and a unit standard deviation. So any normal distribution can be standardized to follow a normal distribution with a mean of 0 and a unit standard deviation. So the standard normal distribution has all the properties of normal distribution. So you remember that the 95% of the data would fall within plus minus 2 standard deviation under a normal distribution, right? So the exact value, in fact, is 1.96 instead of a 2. So they just used the rounded number to make it simpler, but the exact value is plus minus 1.96. So within these two values, you can find the 95% of the data. And then, so these set scores, as I said, tell you how far a score is from the mean in the unit of standard deviation. So that said, z-score of 1.96 or 2 after rounding means that the score is actually two standard deviations above the mean, whatever the original score is. And the sign tells you if the score is below or above the mean. And the total area under a z-distribution is 1. So when you normalize anything, then it becomes 1, any normal distribution, right? Then the area under the curve is just 1, and which is just basically 100%. And the remaining area in both tail ends, I see this kind of a reddish area, is 2.5% each, right? Because the middle 95%, then the remaining tail ends are 5%, by combining these together. So each, because the normal distribution is symmetric around the center, so you split that 5% into exact halves to these two tail ends. Because normal distribution is such an important distribution, people came up with some technical terms to describe distributions breaking the properties of normal distribution. For example, we say a distribution is skewed to the left or right when the symmetry from the center is broken. And this typically happens when there are outliers in the data set, and especially when the outliers are on the right of the distribution, then this di distribution has a positive skew or is said skewed to the right. So as we just have seen, the distribution is pulled to the right because of the influence from the outliers, right? On the other hand, when the outliers are on the left of the distribution, then this di distribution has a negative skew or is said skewed to the left. And as you can see, the distribution is pulled to the left when there are outliers on the left side of the distribution. Another term, kurtosis, is a term to describe the pointedness or tailedness of a distribution. So here is our normal distribution. And when you have more squares close to the center, then the resulting distribution looks fatter compared to the normal distribution. We call this distribution platykurtic, having a negative kurtosis, where platy means wide, broad in Greek. And a platykurtic distribution has thinner tails at both ends. On the other hand, a distribution is called a leptokurtic, looking more slender than the normal distribution. And this distribution has positive kurtosis with thicker tails, meaning it has more extreme values at both ends than the normal distribution. So this illustration compares the parts of box plot to the corresponding normal distribution side by side. And as you can see, the box plot is showing a perfect symmetry around the median for a perfectly normal distribution. So this first normal distribution is actually showing the corresponding parts of the box plot. So we have Q3 and Q1, which is the IQR, right? And by definition, this IQR contains the 50% in the middle of the data, as shown here. And when the length of whisker is 1.5 times IQR, then the upper whisker is actually corresponding to 2.698 sigma standard deviation. And then the lower whisker is actually corresponding to the negative 2.698 standard deviation. And up to that, boundaries, two boundaries, each contains 24.65%. So if we combine these two together, then it'll become 49.3%, right? Yes. And 49.3% plus 50, so that's 99.3. And remaining tail ends will only contain 0.7. So each will contain 0.035. So 0.7%, so that's 0.035%. So in decimal notation, it'll be smaller. And this one, the bottom normal distribution shows basically the 68%, 95, 99.7% rule, where you can find 68% in the middle within plus minus one standard deviation. And the remaining proportion will be then 32%, right? So each contain about 16%. So, this is the kind of a side-by-side comparison between the box plot and the normal distribution. So, because normal distribution is perfectly symmetric around the center, the location of all three central tendency measures are the same under the normal distribution, right? However, when the symmetry is violated, right? So, in the box plot, even though this band is median, if the distribution if a distribution is a normal distribution, then it also represents the location of mean and the mode. But when the symmetry is violated, in other words, if a distribution is skewed, then the locations of those three central tendency measures start to separate relative to the direction of skewness. So here we have a normal distribution curve on top and the respective box plot representation at the bottom, where Q1, Q2, and Q3 represent corresponding quartiles on each representation. And as we have seen, like before, the box plot is also perfectly symmetric around the median, but when there is a negative skew, right, then the mean is most affected. So the mean is pulled away from the center to the left, then comes median in the middle, and the mode is on the right. So when you have negative skew, then you have this long tail to the left side, which is represented by the long lower whisker of the box plot. And also, the location of the median is not central in the middle of the box, right? And the upper whisker is shortened when there is a negative skew. On the other hand, the positive skew now will change the position of the mode and mean reversed with respect to the median. So location of the median is still in the middle of mode and the mean, but then again, mean is most affected. It is really sensitive to the extreme values or outliers in the distribution. So with a positive skew, the mean is pulled away to the right from the center, and it is actually shown by the elongated upper whisker in the box plot, and then shortened lower whisker in the box plot. And again, the location of the median in the box is off. So the box plot can indicate the violation of symmetry from a distribution.